really took Christian music out of a little niche market and made it more mainstream.
But her venture into pop music caused controversy.
She caught a lot of grief for making a pop record after spending so many years in making Christian music.
The journey that she made from Christian into pop music was incredible, unbelievable, and almost impossible.
Off stage, Amy suffered as she faced the end of a 17-year marriage.
You have no idea the pain that she's been through or what she's been through, and it's been hard on everybody.
I just felt like I was really doing the unspeakable and at the same time feeling like I was coming back to life.
A new marriage to country star Vince Gill and a new baby have brought Amy to the happiest place she has known.
If you ever meet Amy, you're always taken by her beauty. She's a really great person to be around.
Her music has broken sales records and stereotypes, but Amy Grant still struggles with the success and fame that have come her way.
I always believed in the experience of what music could bring to me singing and to people listening. But it's never really been about the famous part.
She's been called a preacher and a pop star, but the only thing she's ever cared about is singing the truth about faith, life, and herself. This is Lifetime's intimate portrait of Amy Grant. Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, hosted by Meredith Vieira.
Question: what happens when two country music superstars meet and fall in love? Well, if they happen to be Amy Grant and Vince Gill, you get a picture-perfect wedding, a whole lot of happy kids, and some of the most beautiful duets you'll ever hear. So this week on our series, Married to a Star, we celebrate Amy and Vince. They were criticized for their decision to be together, but they were true to their love. They figured out how to raise a family under the glare of not one, but two spotlights. And as you're about to find out, staying true to herself and her beliefs is what this remarkable singer's life is all about. This is her story, her words.
Amy Grant is the most successful contemporary Christian recording artist ever. But religion was never all that she wanted to sing about.
What's so balanced about a human being is that they are spirit and soul and body, all those things. And to only engage a conversation about your spiritual life after a while starts to feel like a squeaky wheel.
But no Christian singer had ever crossed over into mainstream music. And when Amy wanted to, there was resistance on both sides. First, when her religious music began playing on pop stations.
I think there was less resistance on the secular side as it was on the Christian side. I remember when she did a show in Detroit, she got a dozen roses handed to her, and in there was a note, and he opened the note, and says, "Turn back now before it's too late."
There was controversy again when she began singing pop songs.
A lot of people are like going, "Man, I think you've crossed the line here. You just can't do this."
Amy's strength to weather the controversy and remain true to herself began in her childhood. She was born in 1960 and grew up in Nashville, Tennessee, the youngest of four daughters to Dr. Burton Grant, a radiologist, and his wife Gloria. The Grants were a church-going family, and Amy went often with her parents and sisters, Kathy, Mimi, and Carol.
We went to church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night.
And like many children, Amy was happy to have the occasional reprieve.
I remember it was the rare Sunday afternoon that Mom would come out and she'd say, "You know, your father's a little bit tired. I don't think we're going to go to church tonight." And I think, "Oh, there is a God. Thank you. I can stay home and play."
The one thing about church that Amy does remember from her childhood was the music.
I don't remember any sermon that I heard as a child, but we sang the same hymns over and over again. And that's really, I'm sure, what shaped my theology.
We'd sing around our table, our breakfast table. It
would sing church songs.
We'll just be in the kitchen and somebody will start a hymn. Or can you name this hymn?
During her young childhood, Amy attended a Christian school. But when she was about 10 years old, her parents put her in a prestigious private girls' school called Harpeth Hall.
We were in uniforms. All girls, everybody had greasy hair, no makeup. I mean, nobody cared.
She liked going and not feeling like she had to put on makeup, not have to wash her hair for 6 days, which she's famous for.
As unappealing as that sounds, it's very freeing. And you made friends on the basis of people you had things in common with. It was just a great environment to be yourself and to not be afraid to try new things.
It was at Harpeth Hall that Amy took her first songwriting class and began to play the guitar. And though she loved to sing, music was still just a hobby for Amy.
You know, I went to school with girls that sang a lot better than I did, but I just loved being a part of music.
Amy's interest in music began to grow more when she was about 14 years old and started attending a new church with her sisters. Unlike the traditional congregation she had grown up in, Belmont Church on Music Row in Nashville was celebrating the free spirit of the early 1970s with song.
It was just a great church for young people with a lot of music. It really influenced Amy.
Everybody was, you know, blue jeans, barefoot. People had flowers in their hair, and they sat up in the windowsills, and you're just picking your way through the crowd. You couldn't even see an aisle, and everybody's got their arms around each other and singing songs.
And all of a sudden, you've got this event happening in Nashville that is a wonderful, spiritual, enlightening time that's happening right down there on Music Row.
I remember a prostitute coming in and giving her testimony, and she said, "Well, preacher, I take my clothes off for a living. Can I go to this church?" And he said, "Ma'am, you give your heart to Jesus. He'll tell you what you can and can't do. That's not my call. Of course, you're welcome here."
It was then, in her early teens, while worshiping and singing at Belmont Church, that Amy had her own spiritual awakening.
It's very possible to grow up in church, and it's really just a cultural experience. And we all have cultural experiences, and some of them are religious, and some are not. I had read this book on my bedside table, the Bible, for years and years, and the connect was that all of a sudden I went, "I believe."
Amy began writing songs to express her newfound faith and sharing the songs with her youth group at Belmont Church.
I think the reason I wrote songs about my faith was I was just trying to round out the repertoire of life. And I had fabulous falling in love songs, fabulous celebrating life songs, or cry your heart out kind of stuff. But nobody was writing songs about faith.
I just remember her always wanting to write songs. I remember particularly going to the beach. I was 16, she was 15, and she took her guitar and kept saying, let's write a song, let's write a song, and I kept saying, "Let's go find boys, you're such a nerd."
When Amy told her mother that she and a friend were going to sing for their classmates at Harpeth Hall, Mrs. Grant decided she should hear the songs before her daughter performed at school.
I said, "Would you like to sing them for Daddy and me first?" And she said, "Yeah." Well, she came downstairs with the guitar, and we sat in the library, and she played and sang some of these, and I sat there with just tears.
In 1975, Amy was 15 years old, a teenager in high school, singing songs for her schoolmates and church group. She had no designs on a career in music.
I wasn't one of those kids that ever, you know, had the toilet plunger that was the pretend microphone, and I stood on the laundry basket or sang into my hairbrush. I never did that.
It wasn't even Amy, but a friend from Belmont Church, Brown Bannister, who had the idea to make a tape of Amy's songs.
I said, "You know, maybe we need to just go in and just put some songs down for your mom and dad." So we went to Belmont College. We went in and used their studio and just put down a really rough tape of those songs.
I think there was one copy, maybe two, and I gave it to my mom and dad. And, you know, I'd be upstairs doing something and they'd have friends over and I'd hear that tape and I'd think, "Oh gosh, they've got another captive. They've locked them in the sitting area and they're playing that tape. Those poor people." That's how I felt about it.
Next, Amy gets a phone call that changes her life.
I got grounded for the phone call. I mean, it's just, you know, I was a kid.
And later, Amy's crossover into pop music causes a backlash.
What is she doing, you know, being all cute, dancing around with some guy in a Christian video?
Grant. grew up the youngest of four daughters in an affluent family in Nashville, Tennessee. She attended church regularly as a child and found a strong connection with the music she learned there. By 1975, Amy was a high school sophomore who could pluck at the guitar and had a hobby of writing songs about God. It was pure chance that her friend Brown Bannister was working for an ambitious young record producer named Chris Christian, who happened to hear Amy's tape.
Brown was making a copy of the tape that he and I had made over at this college, and Chris walks in. And he said, "Well, who's that?" And Brown said, "Well, it's Amy." And Chris said, "Do you think she'd be interested in a record deal?"
Chris literally played Amy's tape over the phone to Word Records, a Texas-based label specializing in contemporary Christian music. They liked the tape, and Amy got an unexpected phone call from Brown.
It was like 10:30 at night, and he's saying, "Hey, you're not going to believe this. Chris got a record deal for you." And being kind of the young, insecure person I was, I thought he was making a joke. And he said, "No, I'm dead serious." And then my father gets on. It was past my phone curfew.
I looked at my watch, and it was past telephone time. She was not to be on the telephone. And so, you know, I just said, "Amy, it makes no difference. You hang up the phone now."
I got grounded for the phone call. I mean, it's just, you know, I was a kid.
The next thing we knew, we had a vice president from Word up here talking to Gloria and I about signing Amy to a one record contract. And, you know, what in the world?
Burton said, "Have you ever heard her sing?" And he said, "No." And Burton said, "Well, don't you think you would want?"
Amy received her parents' permission to sign a contract with Word Records and went into the recording booth.
When we did the first record, she was fairly petrified. And if you hear any of those recordings, she's just singing like, "I love to sing and I love to pray. Da, da, da."
He gave me a new song. He really came down himself and sang.
She was so nervous, she had the lights turned off in the studio and sang in the dark.
I was just self-conscious. And then if somebody came in the control room and the lights are off in the studio, if I just lay low and don't say anything, they don't even know I'm in there.
That first record, titled simply Amy Grant, took a year to record. And another year went by before it was released in 1977, when Amy was 17.
The neat thing about that time, though, was in contemporary Christian music, it was such a new genre in terms of a market that there were no real expectations.
Well, it wasn't like launching an artist in the pop world or launching the artist even in the contemporary Christian music world now. You know, it kind of came out and didn't really make a blip on the Richter scale.
That same year, Amy Grant graduated from high school and was on her way to Furman University in South Carolina. By then, a few people had begun to hear about the teenage gospel singer from Nashville, Tennessee.
I started getting invited to do things. "Would you come sing at this festival? Would you do this? Would you do that?" But the first time I ever sang for people I didn't know was I was invited to come sing at Lakeside Amusement Park. And I wasn't in the phone book, but Brown's name was on the record, so Brown got the call. He said, "Hey, I got a call. Somebody wants you to come sing at Lakeside Amusement Park. It's $500. And without blinking an eye, I said, "God, $500. I mean, I've been saving up for college. If I blow $500 to go sing at Lakeside Amusement Park, I'm going to show up my freshman year with like zero entertainment budget." And he's going, "No, they pay you."
Amy's first album did well enough for Word Records to want a second one. So between her classes, Amy was writing and searching for songs. When she was given a song called My Father's Eyes, she knew she'd found something that spoke to her.
Well, the first line of the song is, "I may not be every mother's dream for her little girl." And the song was written by a man. So obviously he was thinking, "I might not be the dream son-in-law." But something just about my emotional makeup, it resonated with me. And I remember just thinking, that's the prettiest thing I've ever heard.
"I may not be every mother's dream for her little girl."
Amy Amy's second album, titled after the song My Father's Eyes, secured her as a favorite performer in the world of contemporary Christian music.
That song obviously started her musical career. She had that first album, like I said, but I think that My Father's Eyes was the first song that really caught people's attention.
Unfortunately, not all of the attention that came Amy's way was welcome.
It was hard in college being known as a gospel singer. You go to a frat party, you know, oh, you're the one that sings gospel music. And I just see this, I would see this veil come over their face. Like, I've already made 8 decisions about what kind of person you are. I will never invite you to a party.
Despite the awkward label, Amy enjoyed performing, although the rigorous life of a young singer was taking its toll on her.
I would finish up my classes on Friday in Greenville, and I would maybe fly to Portland and do a Friday night show. Seattle, do a Saturday night show, and sing somewhere Sunday morning, and then fly home. And it was like that month after month after month.
Adding to the pressure, Amy was booked on tours during her summer breaks. At the time, female Christian singers like Amy performed alone to pre-recorded music tracks. Amy's managers felt her show would be stronger if she were paired with a guitar player for a more upbeat performance.
And what Amy needed was somebody who could handle any situation, get up with a guitar, and sing back up or sing.
They naturally chose the man who had written her hit song, My Father's Eyes, Gary Chapman. As Amy and Gary toured together in the summer of 1980, they began to fall in love.
He was just so much fun. He's got a hilarious sense of humor. He's brilliant, very engaging, wonderful to talk to. Through the course of that summer, we were starting to spend time together apart from work.
The young couple really had something to celebrate when in 1981, My Father's Eyes was nominated for a Grammy for Best Gospel Performance. Even though she did not win, Amy was stunned to receive the recognition.
I knew about the Grammys. I think I'd probably watched the Grammys. I assumed that I had. But I never considered myself a part of anything that would be a part of that.
With a Grammy nomination and a growing audience, Amy's schedule of school and work was becoming too hectic. She transferred from Furman University to Vanderbilt University in her hometown of Nashville, where she could be closer to her family and Gary. She was 21 years old and still looking at singing as a youthful hobby.
I just can't stress enough that I had no agenda.
I think she just kept thinking it was going to, you know, finally end at some point.
Far from ending, Amy's star was rising in the world of Christian music. In 1982, it exploded with the album Age to Age.
I think it's probably the single best Christian record that's ever been made, from beginning to end. It had commercial appeal, and yet it had heart.
Age to Age became the first contemporary Christian album to go platinum, selling more than 1 million copies, and this time, Amy won a Grammy Award.
There's so many levels of what winning a Grammy Award means. Is there's things it means personally, and there's things it means professionally. It's an honor, and it's something that they can never take away from you.
At 22, after 6 albums, Amy finally began to believe that she could make a career out of music, but something had to give.
Her music career and the time away from school took its toll.
I called my father and said, I either stay in school and get a degree, or I consider this my job.
In 1982, with just 1 semester left before graduation, Amy dropped out of college to focus solely on music. That same year, Amy also took a leap in her personal life and married her longtime boyfriend, Gary Chapman.
The event was a fine, fun event that we thoroughly enjoyed.
Now married, Amy and Gary's career continued to flourish. Their work won several Dove Awards given by the Gospel Music Association and back-to-back Grammy Awards in 1984 and 85.
It's been said before, but all of us just want to thank the Lord Jesus because he made music a wonderful thing. Thank you so much.
Next, mainstream audiences discover Amy Grant.
And we'd go to L.A. and sell out the Forum and see these record executives show up and go, how'd this happen?
And later, troubles in Amy's marriage show up in her songs.
And I remember Gary hearing some of the songs saying, I don't really appreciate how I feel after hearing this song.
25-year-old Amy Grant had become the most successful Christian recording artist ever. With her husband Gary Chapman writing and touring with her, Amy had released a platinum album and won 3 Grammy Awards. But she was virtually unknown beyond the niche market of Christian radio and record outlets.
But she was selling, you know, 10, 12, 13, 14,000 seats in concert. And we'd go to LA and sell out the Forum, and you'd see these record executives show up and go, "How'd this happen?"
In 1985, Word Records agreed to have A&M Records distribute Amy's upcoming album, Unguarded, in secular markets.
The groundbreaking part to me was really that a girl that was openly saying things about her faith in God could be accepted by mainstream radio.
Unguarded not only won Amy her 4th consecutive Grammy Award, but her first top 30 hit with the song Find a Way. But as Amy's voice began to find ears in mainstream music, the world of Christian music fought hard against letting her go.
I think there was less resistance on the secular side as there was on the Christian side. I remember when she did a show in Detroit, she got a dozen roses handed to her, and in there was a note, and he opened the note and says, "Turn back now before it's too late."
The industry and churches and people like that kind of claimed her, "This is our person. You know, we own her." And I'm not sure Amy ever gave over that piece of real estate to him.
In the 10 years since Amy first stood in a recording booth, she had released 9 albums to wide success. And yet, Amy Grant began to question the path her life was taking and doubt whether her status as a star was really what she wanted.
Amy, even to this day, fights that position of, "I've done something."
I always believed in the experience of what music could bring to me singing and to people listening. But it's never really been about the famous part. There's probably part of me that did never really want those shoes.
The sort of star or celebrity or success and all the crazy stuff that comes with it was not important to her. She really needed to make that separation.
But no matter her feelings, as long as Amy was making music, she could not escape fame. She didn't even look for her next break. It came to her. Amy was stunned when Peter Cetera, the lead singer of Chicago, invited her to perform a duet with him. The song was "The Next Time I Fall."
You know, I grew up with a lot of Chicago records, and I remember just kind of sliding down the wall going, "No way! I mean, what happened? Was there a sonic blast and all female singers were killed but me? I mean, you've got to be kidding."
Despite the high times of her career, Amy's life was not all happiness. Behind the veil of publicity and stardom, Amy's marriage was struggling.
Amy was going through a lot of stuff then, and a lot of personal stuff. A huge part of what was difficult was her relationship with Gary at the time, and her marriage and her home life.
It'd be hard to say what all the dynamics were, but I think on some level there was probably some competition inside of our marriage. And I don't know where it started. I don't know, you know, if we could have figured out how to stop it. But in any circumstance where there's competition going on, what there can't be is nurturing.
As Amy began to write songs for her 11th album, Lead Me On, she could not ignore the feelings inside her.
In the songwriting world, you can kind of take an idea, then you let your dreamy side or your fantasy side or your unspoken anguish, you can let all those things come out. I was just exploring all of the doubting sides of my life that I really had not explored that way.
Faithless Heart is one of my favorite songs that she's ever recorded. And it is just a gut-wrenching song, but it talked about really hard things and talked about really difficult battles of the heart.
With the help of counseling and therapy, Amy and Gary stayed together. Then, in 1987, the couple welcomed a new phase in their marriage when Amy became pregnant.
I loved being pregnant. I love the feel of a baby inside my body. I loved having big breasts. I loved nursing. I loved everything. To me, the whole childbirth experience was so sensory. It was just sensory overload.
Late in Amy's pregnancy, she was in the studio recording Lead Me On when her baby surprised her.
We really didn't know when this child was going to show up, because it was kind of off again, on again, when he might come. So I was in the recording studio Thursday night. There were some circumstances involved that we felt like it was probably the best thing for me to have him induced. And so I delivered Friday afternoon. I'm on the phone with Brown Friday afternoon trying to pick a key for the next song, and I was back in the studio Monday.
Matthew Garrison Chapman was born in September of 1987, and before he was a year old, set out on tour with his parents.
We left on a bus when he was 11 months old and basically finished a tour when he was turning two, for the most part, traveling that whole time. And it was an absolute study in sleep deprivation.
In 1990, Amy had her second child, a daughter, Millie, and she added a fifth Grammy Award to her shelf for Lead Me On. But she had reached a creative crossroads. She had been recording songs for the contemporary Christian marketplace for 15 years. And though her music had been introduced to mainstream audiences, Amy was feeling the urge to create music completely outside the religious realm.
She had reached a point in her Christian career that she felt like she wanted to expand her base, I think.
She just wanted to talk about things that, you know, just love, just life. Not life in context of God necessarily, you know, just life and love.
Amy began working on an album called Heart in Motion. And to put a complete change on her musical style, she brought in a new producer, Keith Thomas, who gave Amy the start of what would become her biggest song ever.
All I had in the song was the hook, baby, baby, you know, and I said, you know, just something about the hook I think is working, so can you develop a lyric around that hook? And she took it and wrote the lyric.
Keith Thomas wrote that music. I cannot take any credit for the brilliance of that. And when I heard it and just went, oh my gosh, you are a genius. Will you please let me be involved on the lyric?
As inspiration for the words, Amy looked to her new daughter Millie and wrote lyrics that expressed the deepness of a mother's love for her child, set to an all-out pop tune.
Played the song for A&M and Word, and both companies had a problem with it.
I'm sure there at the time there was some people scratching their heads trying to figure out how to market this record.
The Christian record company was saying, "Oh my gosh, you know, this is not Christian music. It's just a flat-out pop tune." And I'm sitting there going, "Uh-huh." And then A&M is saying, she does not have the pop credibility to deliver this.
With both record companies nervous, the song was released without a big push. But it soon began to gain its own momentum at radio stations and climb the Billboard Top 100 chart.
I could see the momentum on the charts. And, you know, that week was probably the most chart aware I've ever been in my life before or since.
Baby Baby hit number one on the pop charts, and after 15 years and 12 albums, the whole world finally knew who Amy Grant was. But inside Amy's core market of Christian music, there was backlash.
For Amy to do a video just like everybody else in pop music does, that was ice-breaking.
I remember seeing one of her videos where she had this really cute guy dancing around in her video, and I remember going, I wonder what people are gonna do to her about this. And what is she doing, you know, being all cute, dancing around with some guy in a Christian video?
And it was stressful for a while there. A lot of people were like going, man, I think you've crossed the line here. You just can't do this.
Although Amy did not win a Grammy that year, Heart in Motion was nominated in four categories, including a nomination for Best Pop Performance, and Amy was thrilled.
A hit song has its one chance to be the current hit, and then it's yesterday's news. But that one tour, when it was the current hit, and we would start that song, it was an energy tidal wave that started at the back of an arena. And it was absolutely euphoric.
Next, Amy makes the most painful and difficult decision of her life.
I just felt like I was really doing the unspeakable.
And later, Amy embraces the legacy of her music.
It was different than anything she's ever done, and that inspires you as an artist.
when Lifetime's intimate core platinum album Heart in Motion with the number one pop song Baby Baby, and been named one of People magazine's 50 most beautiful people of the year. In October, Amy welcomed her third child, a daughter she named Sarah. But despite her career achievements and growing family, Amy still struggled with the pains of a difficult marriage.
She handled the relationship more gracefully than probably anybody I know. Just working on everything she could possibly work on to make it right.
Even though there were things about my life that were so difficult for me personally, I think that the option of divorce was not an option.
In 1993, Amy received an invitation to appear in a televised Christmas special hosted by country music star Vince Gill, whom she had become acquainted with through the course of celebrity events and appearances.
If you ever meet Amy, you're always taken by her beauty and by her eyes and by her willingness to engage you in conversation, you know, and it's compelling.
That same fall of 1993, Amy was in the studio recording a new album and found she was having trouble with the title track.
I was in the studio with Keith Thomas doing House of Love, and I said, oh my gosh, you've just pitched this too high. I can't sing the harmony part.
Threw out some names to do this duet, and Amy brought up Vince.
Naturally, she called me a guy to go sing the high part that was too high for her.
I said, it's really high.
Well, I get you. Amount of money, you'll be coming back to you.
Working together gave Amy and Vince the chance to form a strong friendship.
I just liked him. It wasn't like I was going, hey, he's a man and I'm a woman, I wonder what he thinks, because we were both married. I just flat liked him.
We just hit it off, you know, it was kind of like a soulmate sister, or I don't even know how to describe it.
I just gravitated toward him because I just felt encouraged and lifted up when I was around him.
House of Love was released in 1994, and Amy finally took a much-earned rest. For the next 3 years, she stayed at home, raising Matt, Millie, and Sarah, and continually trying to work through the troubles of her marriage. As Amy began writing lyrics for the album Behind the Eyes, more than ever before, her anguish came out in her songwriting.
I remember bringing songs home and playing them in the kitchen and kind of going, these songs aren't necessarily putting my best foot forward. And I remember Gary hearing some of the songs saying, I don't really appreciate how I feel after hearing this song.
Who knew love would come walking through my door, turn the light on somewhere down inside.
Never did try to hide that she was not having a struggle with Gary. She began to expose that in her music. Behind the Eyes was just important for her to finally put into some real thoughts and some words something that really conveyed where I'm struggling at today, because I think she was brokenhearted in a very deep way.
Behind the Eyes won a Dove Award for Best Pop Contemporary Album, but the success of the album only reflected the deep pains that Amy had expressed through her songs. She was unhappy and felt trapped.
Her eyes just looked so dead at this point that I think we just wanted her healthy.
I just felt like I was very lost. I felt hopeless, and I think that I was just trying to find a way out.
Finally, in 1999, Amy filed for divorce from Gary Chapman after 17 years of marriage.
I think it was hard on her where it caused people that she loved
love pain. All of the kids, because they loved Amy and they loved Gary. You can't always explain fully the reasons to a child.
I just felt like I was really doing the unspeakable, and at the same time, feeling like I was coming back to life.
Amy began spending more time with her friend Vince Gill, who had divorced his wife 2 years earlier. When they were seen together in public, rumors of impropriety began to spread.
The demand from the Christian marketplace was, tell us, give us a quick answer why this happened, and we'll move on. Amy wasn't about to do that.
In the gospel industry, I think it was hard on her to be a human being, because we all put her on a pedestal. Until you've walked a mile in her shoes, you don't know what she's been through.
Responding to rumors is like trying to put out a grass fire in bare feet. I think it would have been dishonest for me to say, all of what you're thinking is not true. People see electricity between two people, and people saw struggle between Gary and me. And, you know, and it was all overlapped. I'm not gonna try to justify the decisions that I made that might not have been the best decision.
You know, it's just life, you know, and it's kind of messy sometimes. And I think at some point you go, I don't have to go convince the world what's right, what's wrong. She has to lay her head down on the pillow. I have to lay my head down on the pillow and answer to God without anybody looking.
Next, Amy takes a second turn at happiness.
Like most things in my life that I don't plan for very well, we just said, let's just go ahead and get married now.
When Lifetime's intimate portrait of Amy Grant has shared her faith in God with the world through song. Her album, Age to Age, was the first platinum album ever recorded by a contemporary Christian artist. And she broke through in the pop charts with the number one hit, Baby Baby. In 1999, Amy divorced her husband, Gary Chapman, and weathered the painful rumors about her new relationship with Vince Gill. By the spring of 2000, Amy and Vince decided to marry, but they weren't interested in planning a big wedding or waiting for one.
We knew we wanted to be married, and like most things in my life that I don't plan for very well, we just said, let's just go ahead and get married now.
When? What would be the best time? You know, and it kind of wound up with this week's open. Let's try to.
And then figured we could pull it together in 3 weeks. And we told friends and family, and we had a real small ceremony on the side of a hill.
At these cabins, not far from here, where we have some property, and these cabins are over 150 years old. This is the most spectacular view you've ever seen.
It was just beautiful. It was outdoors. It was in the country. I was not wearing a designer dress, and I was barefoot.
We didn't tell anybody, but we had bagpipers. And after the vows, they came up this hill, and it was so beautiful because it could have been several hundred years ago.
Marrying Vince has finally brought Amy to a place of happiness and peace that she had not known for many years.
By the time I felt married, I felt like the most loved woman in the world.
He really respects her and gives her a place of honor, and he encourages her. And I think she does the same for him.
Even though they had four children between them, a few months into their marriage, Amy and Vince discussed the idea of having a baby together.
We just said, we can either be married and enjoy our later years together, seeing the end of Jenny and Matt and Millie and Sarah's childhood, or else we can start the whole thing over again.
1 year later, they welcomed the birth of Karina Grant Gill.
We had Karina, and it really has made an amazing impact on us as a blended family.
In 2002, with a new husband and a new baby, Amy had the opportunity to reflect on her upcoming 25th anniversary as a recording artist.
She wanted to do something very authentic, very real, that really inspired her.
For more than a decade, Amy had been swinging away from the Christian music that was her roots. Now she wanted to go back to her beginnings and chose to do an album of hymns, which she would call Legacy.
I was just thinking, okay, I know hymns. I've been in church a long time. I've sung a lot of hymns. And hymns can be really boring.
When somebody says Hymns record, they think, you know, oh my gosh, here comes Christy Lane, Andy Griffith, and Tennessee Ernie Ford, and they're going to sing the gospel favorites. I think that's the last thing in the world she wanted to do.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling.
The best part of doing this legacy record was getting to revisit all these hymns that I know like I know the back of my hand and to try to breathe new life into them.
It was different than anything she's ever done, and that inspires you as an artist, because if you're not moved by the work that you're doing, you can't expect to move anybody else with it.
I think every unarticulated place in my heart where I have maybe struggled with the things that have been given to me so abundantly, and with the places that I have fallen short, I think immersing myself in these songs it just reminded me again that I didn't want to cry. It was never me who had it all together. You know, it was the beauty of faith, the beauty of the boundless love of God is that He sees us for who we are and loves us.
After 25 years in music, Amy Grant at 41 still walks the path that led her to sing in the first place. It is a path between her and God. And today, as always, her songwriting reflects that journey.
After the fire is over, after the ashes cool, after the smoke is blown away, I will be here for you.
When I listen to Amy's voice, there's breath, there's emotion, and I think that God comes to us in those simple moments through her music.
I think her enthusiasm for life makes her special. I mean, she is so in the present. When she's talking to you, you are the only other person on earth.
Her whole physical and spiritual place that she sets herself, it's warm, it's inviting, and where she comes from is very truthful.
I was always enamored by her ability to communicate with people. You know, that's the gift that Amy has that I think is the most precious of all.
You know, you get almost halfway through your life and you start evaluating how you're living your life and what matters and what your priorities are.
All that is good and true between us, this will remain the same.
I'm glad to be where I am.
It's great to see Amy Grant looking so happy and sounding so fulfilled. I guess when you can harmonize your spiritual life and your personal life, you get to make some beautiful music. And that's exactly what Amy does in her new album, Legacy, Hymns and Faith. For Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, I'm Meredith Vieira.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus.